I know you feeling him. 500 days left into the new millennium. You hearing them trumpets and the sky cracks. The first, the last, it won't pass. So don't be caught slipping, brother. Don't be tripping, brother. Cause when I see him, I'm giving
really
brother.
They say we move too much, we do too much. And if you step against us, then you lose too much. Ain't no stopping what we doing when the spirit is moving. Don't be hating what I'm doing, I'm the vessel he's using. Everywhere I be, they try to judge me. They try to shake me, they try to buzz me. But they can't break me, cause I'm down with Christ. Dog child, a new nation, and we feel alright. Well, alright.
Yes, sir.
Him today. Thank you, Lord. you're still in control. With praise is the word, you see it's more than a sound. Our praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. Come on. So as long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to pray.
Declare.
makes a way where there's no way. He is the way where there's no way. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Keep your head up today. Keep your head up today. I don't care what it feels like. I don't care what it looks like. Don't look down. Keep your head up because he's making a way. Don't close your eyes. Keep your eyes open for a way because he's making the way. He is the way. Lord, we look to you as our way maker today, our miracle worker, our promise keeper. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You are Jesus. That's who he is today.
Praise you, Jesus. Where's Sully? This is Araceli. She just felt something by the Holy Spirit.
As we were worshiping and the song continued to pray, God spoke to me and he said, this is the season where you're going to find me in the unseen. This is the season where God is going to literally move in the unseen. I felt it and the song just came. Our faith is going to see the work of God behind the closed heavens where we don't see anything. We have to know that God is moving on behalf of our prayers. And when they're seeing that there's nothing happening, that's when the most is happening. We are going to meet, our faith is going to meet him in the unseen. Today you have to stretch out and believe that. Believe that God is going to meet us in the unseen, because this is the season where God is already working miracles. Even though you don't see it, you don't understand, you gotta see it. Because this is the season where he's working behind the scenes, behind everything that's going on, where we think that nothing's happening. That is when the most is happening. So God just wanted me to encourage us today. He says, they will find me, we will find him in the unseen.
Yes,
you have to see that.
Yes,
you have to see that by the Spirit. I pray that you get that by the Spirit. At the moment when you feel like nothing is happening, shift that and say, God, this is when the most is happening, because I see you. I see it. It's happening. You declare it. You believe it. So this is the season to find him in the unseen. Amen.
Hey, come on. Come on.
If you're believing God for a miracle, like an out of control, it doesn't seem like it's possible. If you're believing God for a miracle in this place, we don't usually do this, but I want you to come up here to the front right now. Whether if it's a physical miracle, a financial miracle, if it's something that you need mentally, emotionally, whatever it is, I just feel the miracle working presence of God in this place, and we want to stand. And I know that sometimes it's hard to come up here, but come up here and be surrounded, and let's praise God with you in this place. Come on and lift your hands in this place. Let's agree with these people, God. Lord, I thank you right now, God, that we overcome, God, by the word of our testimonies, God. And I know that every single one of us in this place has a testimony of the but God moments that you brought us through, God. And I thank you, God, that even as you just spoke right now, God, that you are moving and you are working. You are doing the most in the unseen moments, God. So right now, when it seems quiet right now, in those moments where it seems like you're not moving, God, we trust you, God. And we stretch forth our faith today with our brothers and sisters in this house. Lord, I speak healing over their bodies, wholeness over their bodies. Lord, I speak wholeness to relationships, God. I speak, Lord, your peace to their homes in the name of Jesus. I speak financial breakthrough in the name of Jesus. I speak explosion, God, in the areas that need to have explosion. Lord, I just thank you, God, that you are a miracle working God. That you are a miracle working God. And Lord, we call forth your miracles today, God. We call forth your miracles today, God. We call forth the miracles today, God. That your signs and wonders are for today. That they are for today by the blood that you shed on Calvary, God. And Lord, we believe it today, God. We stand in faith with each other today, God. I thank you, God, for the testimonies, God, that are going to come forth from this place. God, for the testimonies that are going to come forth, Lord, saying how you made a way out of no way, God. How you healed their body when they were sleeping, Lord. How you touched their mind, God. How they woke up, God, and they weren't the same, Lord. I thank you, God, that we believe it today, God. We trust you today, God, that there's nothing too big for you, God. There's nothing too small for you, God. Lord, we put our faith in you, God. And we trust you today, God. I thank you, God, for the miracle moments, God. Miracles that are going to happen in every little way, God. We believe it today, God. We believe it today, God. Lord, we trust you today, God. We thank you, God, that you're a faithful God. You never leave us. You never forsake us, Lord. And Lord, we believe today, God. We will not be blinded, God, by what we're the mountain, Lord. We will not be moved by the mountain, God. I thank you, God, that the mountain has to move, Lord. And we know it will move, God, because that is who you are. That is who you are. You are a healer. You are a redeemer. You are a savior, God. You are mighty on our behalf. So, Lord, we thank you for it today, God. We command every situation and every storm to be quiet. And we command doors to open for breakthrough to come. In the name of Jesus. Come on and give him some praise in this place.
Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Stay up here. Those of you that are up here, stay right where you are. We're going to take up communion. We're going to take up communion in just a moment. And this is a perfect opportunity. Because what communion is, it's not just remembering something past. It's accepting what was done for what is present. It's accepting what Christ did for what was present. Before we do that real quick, Pastor Rich, did you have something to share?
A scripture to affirm everything that was spoken.
Please do.
This is from Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans and thoughts that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans for peace and well-being, and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope.
Yeah.
Then you will call on me,
yeah,
and you will come and pray to me,
yes,
and I will hear you.
Yeah.
Your voice, I will listen to you. Then with deep longing you will seek me and require me for a vital necessity.
Yeah.
And you will find me when you search me,
yes,
with all your heart.
Hallelujah. Amen. Come on. Give God the glory right where you are. Thank you, Lord. Let's go ahead and give out the elements. And those of you I know that you received, we're going to take this up. And again, I want to encourage you today that communion is not just remembering what was done, but it's accepting what was done for what is present. Jesus said, do this. Take my bread, for it was broken for you. So the first element, what takes place, is we accept when his body was broken. Now, right now, whatever feels broken is made whole. Whatever feels broken is made whole. We accept what was done for what is now. And then the blood, which declares that we are forgiven. Past, present, and future, the blood that came to redeem us of all our sin. And declare that we are righteous. Now hear me, all through the scriptures, whenever you had a position of righteousness, you were absolutely blessed by God. Righteousness is a position of blessing, automatically. And so right now, those areas that would seem broken, come on now, we receive what was done for what is now the blessing of the Lord. Righteousness, forgiveness, redemption. So let's go ahead and take this. The first thing, we're going to lift up this bread. Father, we do this. We do this not just in remembrance, but in acceptance of what was done for what is now. Of what was done, your body that was broken and bruised. So now we accept wholeness, where we may feel a deficit. We may feel brokenness, wherever that may feel. God, we claim and we accept and we expect manifested wholeness in the name of Jesus. So as we take this, we accept manifested wholeness. Take and receive today. Healing, wholeness right now. Body, soul, and spirit. Some relationships. I see relationships coming back to wholeness in the way God has destined them to be. I command that to be now. Straighten up. Straighten up. Like a chiropractic move. Boom, right there. Boom, right there. In the name of Jesus. Boom, right there. Healing from the inside out. Healing. No matter what the report is you are healed and made whole by the broken body of Jesus. You are now whole in Jesus' name. We now lift the cup. We lift this cup, Father. You said do this. That this cup is in recognition of the blood of a new covenant. Wow. The blood that forgives us of all our sin. Woo. Once and for all. Once and for all, we have been redeemed from the curse of the law. Praise God. Hallelujah. And this blood says that we are righteous. And if we are the righteous, your word says that the righteous are blessed. And so right now, we command as we take this today, we accept what was done, the righteousness, the forgiveness, and now the blessing. We accept it into the now. Right now, where it's needed most, we command that blessing. Let's take and receive right there. Come on.
Jesus Christ.
Wow, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit, as you're moving even now. You're moving, you're moving, you're moving. You're moving far beyond this room. Holy Spirit, you're working far beyond what we see. You're working far beyond what we feel. Holy Spirit, we thank you that we do feel you, but you even that, you're working so far beyond even what we feel. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Boy, do you feel his presence here today? Oh, thank you, Jesus. We give you glory. One more time, let's thank God in advance. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you. God, thank you for your love and the way you show your love. Hallelujah. 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 Praise you, mighty God. Praise you. Praise you, mighty God. Amen. Wow. Glory to God. That's worship right there, y'all. Woo. Thank you, Father. And I look forward to hearing the testimony that manifested, the manifested work of Jesus. Amen. Well, we're going to take a time we call 5 for 5. We're going to take 5 minutes and just turn around. Say hello to at least 5 people, the number of grace, because grace happens right in here, y'all. We're going to love each other. So say hi to somebody if there's somebody you don't know. Or just turn around, somebody next to you. Say hello. We want to welcome you to DWCLA Worship Center. Even those that are online today, thank you, online family. So good to see you. Glad you're here.
Help us to love and see each other the way you love and see us. Come on.
My heart is always long for something more. I search the stars to knock on heaven's door. Creation groans for God to be revealed. Every wound we carry will be healed. My eyes on the sun, Lord, your will be done.
Thine is the kingdom, yeah. The power, the glory, yeah. Forever and ever, yeah. He finished my story, yeah. We're singing freedom. Our testimony will be singing forever.
Check, check. I don't know where the mic is, but I just want to say good morning. We're so glad you're with us today online, worshiping with us. That was so good. I was crying off all my makeup. What a beautiful day to worship and be in the presence of God together. God is so good to us. I'm going to turn this around and let everybody say hello to you today, and then we'll go out into the crowd and say hello. Look at this. And we've got our online family. Good morning, everyone. So good to see what God is doing in this place today. Come on, let's go out. Let's go out in the crowd. Let's go out in the crowd. Oh, here we go. I've got a mic. Let's say hello. Look who's here, Miss Courtney, Miss Janet. Hello, everybody else. Hello, Miss Araceli. Looking beautiful. What a word today. What a word today. Woo! That is awesome. Look at all the beautiful people. Look at this. The Lopez family. Here's my beautiful in-laws. Look at them. Dad, that was powerful. Hi, Mom. Say hi. Hello, hello. We love you. Let's see, what do we got? Oh, look at this. Oh, my goodness. Look at this handsome guy. I can't believe how big he is. Monty's about to bring it today. Monty, say a little something, something. Preview. Give us a preview. Jesus is good. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Look at this. We've got Belize in the house. We got our Belizeans in the house. Charlotte and Miss Constance. Look at this baby right here. Look at this baby, and then look at Zyra. This is my nephew right here. All right, we got, what do we got? Here we got. Oh no! He said Giants all the way. Don't let PB hear that. I don't know if he likes the Giants. We can't do it. Look at this. We got our media team over here today. Look at that. Looking beautiful. Looking handsome. Hey, the dude in the corner. Look at this. We've got some. We've got a double doing here. Look at this. Actually, well, you know, Bradford, but we got Miss Lucretia. It's so hard after worship because we just be crying, good morning, good morning. Oh, Miss Tina, you got little hands. Sleeping in the house of God. It's okay. We'll give him a pass. Here comes. All right. We're going to have a good, right here. What do I got on here? What's going on? Hello, good morning. Oh, you guys look good today. Looking good, mama. Oh, we're so glad you're here with us today. All right, we're getting ready to go on. What up, Greek? All right, let's do this. Let's have a great service. PB.
Woo! I love when the Holy Spirit has control of the service. We want him to just do what he wants to do and to speak and to prophesy and to minister. And just, God, have your way. So being in an environment where there's freedom is a beautiful thing. And to know, oops, the mic. That's all good. Do I have the wrong mic? Okay. And just to know, that's the thing about redemption, to know that you have a right to receive. You have a right to receive all that God has for you. He is not measuring you based on your ups and downs like we measure ourselves. Amen? He is bringing you. He has brought you into the full measure of Christ through Christ and Christ alone. That's the difference. He doesn't measure you. He brought you into the full measure, Colossians says, of Christ. Glory to God. Thank you, Father, for that. Amen. So we're gonna take up our offering today. Are we ready? Ready to give this morning? But I don't always do this, but I want to take a brief moment. I want to give you some financial vision going forward. Can we do that just for a moment? Let's call this a family talk. So this is where we go. We do this off and on. Now understand that as a church, we posture ourselves to see you prosper. Right? We don't come into this place giving, expecting something first. We posture ourselves to give first like Jesus did. So as we believe with you, we're praying that you would believe with us as a family. That's really what church should be. So I want to read you an incredible scripture, and it's in the Message version. And this is 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And the Apostle Paul is talking about sowing seed of finances and what takes place when you do. Okay? And look what he says. Remember, a stingy planter gets a stingy crop. A lavish planter gets a lavish crop. I want each of you to take plenty of time to think it over and make up your own mind what you will give. That will protect you against sob stories and arm twisting. How many thank God you're not arm twisted into giving? God loves it when the giver delights in the giving. Woo! 8 to 11. God can pour on the blessings in astonishing ways so that you're ready for anything and everything. More than just ready to do what needs to be done. As one psalmist puts it, he throws caution to the winds, giving to the needy in reckless abandon. His right living, right giving ways never run out and never wear out. This most generous God, who gives seed to the farmer that becomes bread for your meals and is more than extravagant with you because he gives you something you can then give away. I love that. Which grows into a full-formed lives, robust in God, wealthy in every way, so that you can be generous in every way, producing with us great praise to God. That's exciting. I mean, and Paul's just reminding us of the God that we serve. He's reminding us of the God that we have a relationship with, right? And he's reminding us of the great pleasure and the privilege. We are no longer under the law where we give or else. We are under Christ where we give and we're blessed. We give because we are, see, the old covenant we used to give to get blessed. The new covenant, we are blessed, so we give. So it's a whole different mindset. It's a whole different, posture with us and God. So think about this for a moment. As a church, we're nonprofit. We're nonprofit. In other words, we don't give you a bill or give you some, tell you, we'll give you service. We'll give you a product, but you first have to pay this, right? We're not like a regular business where you pay the value to get your product. And this is why, because the product that we serve has eternal intangibles, things that even money can't buy. Your freedom, your salvation, relationship with God, eternal quality life, eternal life. I mean, I can go on and on, y'all. Righteousness in God. So we our product are the eternal intangibles that you can never get. So what do we do? What is our expectation? So as a church, we, because we are the gospel, we are giving whether you give or not. We're going to give. Listen, I'm going to be here whether you're here or not. I'm going to preach whether you listen or not. I'm going to give grace freely whether you give it back or not, right? That's who we are because of what God has done in our lives. So we as the church, what we do is we believe is we are believing that we as a people, as a family, would give the same value that we have received. Because you don't get a bill. But we all are responsible for what God is doing in a faith, hope, love type of way. Amen. So this is our vision. What is our expectation? Not too long back, and I've had this happen a few times where people have actually done some phenomenal things. And many of you that give based on where you are, that is an astonishing thing in a day and age where society is trying to teach us to be stingy, distrusting. You know, we don't, you know, I'm going to keep it all for myself because I don't know type of generation. So it is to us, we're always very, taken back by the generosity of God's people to unite first with God. To unite first with God, hear God, and give what God tells you to give. I mean, that's a miracle in and of itself in the generation that we are. So I got this question, what are we expecting? Are we expecting to give in order just to get by? Are we expecting to give so that the church just gets by? Well, I want to do enough to get by. I've had a few people at times just recently, a couple people, and I know that God is speaking, but one person in particular who happens to be a very generous giver anyways, the bedrock of what happens in this place financially, said, Pastor, our dream, and it will happen, we're going to buy you a church. We're going to buy you a building. I'm like, okay. Tell me about it. And yeah, don't threaten me with a good time, right? And I believe it, you know, it stirs me, provokes when somebody says that, and when they say it, coming from the person that said it, I believe it. I'm expecting, but see, my expectation is on God, not man. So people could say that, but, you know, I appreciate that. Another person said to me, Pastor, our dream is not just to pay off pay off our house, to pay for tuition for all our kids, to retire debt-free. But our dream is to pay rent for the church. Anything you need, we want to pay rent. And the reason why we want to do that is so that you can put that towards other things that God has told you to do. We don't want you having to worry about having to do that. Now, that type of expectation provokes me because it began to stir in me even more so. What are we expecting, right? What am I expecting? What are we expecting for the church? What are we expecting as families? Do we expect just to get by? Is our dream just the house being paid off, car being, you know, having debt freedom, but we don't think of God's kingdom, right? And that's what was beautiful to me, is the expectation that we, not only will we pay off our homes, not only will we have debt freedom in retirement, not only can we believe for our business to be built up in a way that now I'm giving away free things to the community, I'm purchasing buildings for our city, I'm impacting people that are in need, amen, because I know that's what our vision is. And many of you are doing that. You're doing those things. And that's the expectation, I believe, that God wants us to begin to walk with, that we don't short-circuit ourselves. We don't just believe. So I want to encourage you. If you're only thinking about yourself, you're thinking too small. God wants to get more to you so he can get more through you in Jesus' name. Don't think small. Don't think just get by. Think, God, I thank you. Not only is my bills paid up, my debts paid off, but my bank is full, so that at every time and everything, like he's saying here in Scripture, Paul is saying we can expect it. That not only am I taken care of, but I want the church to overflow. I want my mom to have what she needs to have. I want my kids to have what they have. But I want your kingdom to also be blessed because of my life. Come on, y'all. I'm trying to encourage us to be dominion takers, those that think of kingdom life, because what you expect is where it begins to flow. We heard this, that the things, the areas that you're at rest with, grace flows more to, even more so, because we begin to settle that God is in control. God, I'm not going to worry about this anymore. And we begin to see things begin to manifest. Things try to get you to worry, but that's not what we are. We're not worriers, amen. We're believers, therefore we're givers, and you can expect. And I'm saying this before we give today, because I want you to be blessed in every way. Our posture is this, is as we believe with you, I want to encourage you, believe with us. Don't just expect to get by. Don't just give in a way that we just get by. Let's begin to overflow. And listen, you have a right to expect your seeds to multiply. Paul said it. Take that scripture. Put it wherever you got to put it. And every day begin to declare blessing to your career, to your job, over your kids, over everything that you are, and you're going to have it. Amen? So I want to show you, I don't always do this, but I want to give you as kind of a, this is an example, but this is really where we are. This week, let's put up the bills that we got to pay. We have rent, $24, electric, $340. Our quarterly kids material that we pay for the whole quarter comes in. We got all our digital stuff that we have. That's $260. Travel weekly supplies that prepare us for the next Sunday or all the things that we do. And the church does, as you know, pay our salary and we get a housing. And so what happens is when the money comes in, just like any of you business entrepreneurs or you homemakers, you with your managing your money, whatever comes in, then you have to decide what's priority. What are we going to give? What are we going to do? What I'm expecting is that to be paid off all the way. Every week we expect that it would just overflow. So wherever you are today, you give from where you are. there have been people that when I've showed them, they're like, hey, I'll pay your electric bill. Oh, you got it? Okay, let's get that. Yeah, I'll pay for the kids quarterly. Praise God, let's do that. Hey, I can pay for your rent. We've had a few people do that. We'll pay for that amount. And maybe you can't reach any of those, but your $30 will go into the full amount that we need for that whole week. Are you seeing this? But as a family, based on wherever you are, you give what God puts, then we're not having to decide. We as a church, we got this covered, Pastor. Let's do it. Let's pay it. And let's go on to overflow in Jesus' name. Amen. So that's where we are. If you need an envelope, lift up your hands right where you are. We can give. You give by check. Write it out to Destiny Worship Center. You can give right there. Just scan that code right there, and it'll take you straight to your giving, the giving app. You can text it, the amount, to 84321. 84321, and then you register, and you can give any day, any time. And I do have to say this. I love when we see during the week people aren't even in church and don't have to be reminded, and people are giving more than ever during the week, and that is a big deal. Praise God. Thank you very much for not allowing it to be out of sight, out of mind. Are you ready to believe God for this? That as we hit it, we knock it out as a kingdom. We also expect above and beyond in our own personal lives. Father, right now, as we begin to give, as we give this, I agree, we agree, we posture by faith with every person, every individual, every family, every business owner. God, we command blessing and increase to just begin to overflow and manifest in such a way that your people, that their bills are paid up and paid off, so now they can begin to use their money to be a blessing to people, to family, to the kingdom. God, we pray even for the church that we have all the things paid off so that we can begin to give freely. Even our vision, Father, to be able to pay people's bills off, to purchase land, to purchase supplies, to be able to impact this community. Father, we believe for the overflow in Jesus' name. Do you agree with me today? Amen. Let's give him praise. Amen. And let's give. Praise the Lord. Amen. Go ahead and give. Take that moment. Take that moment. Anybody need an envelope, you can raise your hand. We made it a point just to kind of like let it happen. You know, we get through these beautiful moments so fast, and we don't give you time to do it. So thank you, Lord, for your blessing upon every single person, your blessing that's already on us. And when we give, we release that blessing to manifest. Thank you, Jesus, for your goodness. Amen. Today, it is my greatest privilege to introduce a woman of God to come up here and share the word. What can I say? She's an author. She's a professor at the college. She's a mom and a grandma. And she is the director of our women's designer ladies. So I want you to give a big warm welcome to Monica Sterling. Come on up, Monica.
Now I gotta play something.
Woo! Doesn't matter. What the problem? Go on. Work it. Yeah, any type. Situation, he working. Yeah, I don't have no job. Boy, working. Yeah, working. Yeah, when spring some fall.
Yeah, you know what? I am grateful for Kirk and for Ty Tribbett, for Fred Hammond. I'm grateful for them because we were talking about on Wednesday in the Bible study how, you know, we've been delivered from, you know, I've been delivered from DJ Quick. He was all in my spirit and soul, but it just wasn't producing anything great. And so then, you know, Ty and Kirk, they give us something we could bounce to. Because we need, I mean, I don't know about y'all, but I need that. I need to be able to bump in my car and know that he will work it out. All right. So if you haven't guessed it, that is the title of my message today, is He Will Work It Out. Amen. I've been so blessed these last couple of weeks when we're just talking about grace and what it's doing in our lives and how it's in us and how it's through us. And then we've been talking on Wednesdays about faith and how we need to activate our faith and stay in it and work it out. But sometimes, you know, life kind of happens and faith gets a little fleeting for us sometimes. It gets one of those things where, you know, we believe and we trust in God, but sometimes we have those doubts in our minds. And so I just wanted to encourage us today. And the flow of the word, the worship this morning was already in that vein. Like, He will work it out. He will work it out. I want to get into a little bit of scripture. I want to talk to us today about our good friend Daniel in the Bible. Let me just set up his story just a little bit. Daniel was favored by King Darius. Right, he was favored, and during a lot of appointments, Daniel was one who got a promotion, right? And he was also very much set up to run the entire kingdom, right? Well, you know, in our lives, when we get set up for things, for greatness, we got a level of haters that we have to deal with in our lives, right? And so as with Daniel, he had to deal with some haters in his life. They were all appointed, but they were trying to find fault in his work. And there was no fault in his work. His work was immaculate. It met every number. It met every quota. He was not behind. Daniel was pristine in how he presented himself. He was excellent unto the Lord, right? And he took note. King Darius took note of that. And so his haters was like, listen, what can we do? What can we do to get him off of this position? What can we do to get rid of him? Because we want to do what we can do, and he's in our way. So they went to King Darius, and okay, guys, listen. I am the director of the women's ministry, meaning I'm low-key feminist. Okay, I'm just going to say it. I'm going to say, so what I'm going to say right now is going to be a little, you know, okay, don't get offended, guys, but this is true about you all. King Darius got his ego stroked a little bit, right? And Pastor Angelus reminded us that when we activate our egos, we're edging God out of our lives. And so his ego got a little stroked on this particular moment when the guys was like, listen, I think for like 30 days, you should have everybody just pray to you and nobody else. He was like, I'm with that. They were like, oh, but even further, let's just put this in stone. You have to put your stamp on it so that no matter what, in 30 days, they can pray to nobody else. Now, King Darius, he knew about Daniel. He knew about his lifestyle, but his ego got stroked a little. And so he was like, you got it. And then, not shortly thereafter, they was like, we got it in writing, we got it in writing. Okay, good. So you know that your boy Daniel, he's still praying to his God. And the king got like, oh, really? So he already knew, we already knew, right, that Daniel was not going to yield on that thing. He wasn't going to yield on that thing. So this is where we're going to pick up the scripture. This is going to be Daniel 6, 16 through 22. So the king gave the order, and they bought Daniel. Okay, before I read that part. So then the decree was then if somebody got violated, right, praying to another god, that they were going to get thrown into the lion's den. The lion's den. All right, so here we go. So the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel, may your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you. A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den. I mean, this is deep, right? And the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the rings of his nobles, so Daniel's situation might not be changed. Meaning that there was no way nobody was going to come in the middle of the night, including the king himself, whose heart was very vexed by it, was not going to come in the middle of the night and roll that stone away that was going to get Daniel out of that situation. His situation was not going to change. Okay. Then the king returned to his palace and spent the night without eating and without any entertainment being brought to him. He could not sleep. He realized how his ego got in the way. And he remembered all the things that, you know, Daniel did for the kingdom. And he remembered the type of person he was. When he came near, at the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. When he came near the den, he called to Daniel in an anguished voice. "Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, again," he says, "whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lions?" Daniel answered. And right there, I just want to drop the mic, right? Daniel answered. Daniel answered, "May the king live forever. My God has sent his angel, and he shut the mouth of the lions. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done any wrong before you, your majesty." Everybody say, he worked it out. He worked it out. That was the situation. That was a situation that seemingly to Daniel and those around him, all the haters, that he was not going to get out of that. That in other events, when people were thrown into the lion's den, that was sure death. Sure death. The lions was hungry. It was more than one. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been a den. It was more than one. The lions were hungry. And Daniel, I kind of wish that the text lended itself to Daniel's thought process, right? I would love to know what he was thinking at the time. Was he like, dang, the lions? Or was he confident the whole time? I don't know. I would like, because if it were me with my continually praying self, I would be in a little bit of anguish myself, right? I don't like cats, let alone lions. So that probably wouldn't have worked out for me. But Daniel answered, meaning that he had God in his corner and he was delivered from an unfathomable situation, from a situation that did not seem that was going to work in his favor by any stretch of the imagination. So let's just break this down a little bit. I want to talk about a life of faithful convictions. Daniel's life was marked by his unwavering faith in God. He demonstrated that faith by praying to God despite the decree prohibiting it. They said he couldn't do it, but that was not enough in his walk and in his daily proclamation of who God was in his life. That was not enough to say that three times a day is what they knew that he did. Three times a day they knew that Daniel prayed. He said there was a decree, but that does not apply to me. He prayed to God regardless, in spite of the fact that he had to go against his very livelihood and being the administrator of the kingdom. His devotion to God was unyielding, even in the face of danger. My question is, are we willing to stand firm in our faith that way? Even when it's inconvenient? Or in the situation or challenges that we've faced that it may seem impossible or no way out, or if it's just unpopular. Daniel's example challenges us to live out our faith consistently, consistently. There was no question in his mind that they're not talking to me. They're not talking to me. Praying is what I do, right? Serving my Lord is what I do. This is my job, what I do for you guys. But God is first in my life. When facing our modern day lions, In our lives today, the lions may not be literal. They could be if you're in that kind of work, but listen, I don't know. But in our lives, they represent the trials, the things that we go through, our challenges, our adversities that we encounter. We have health crises, right? In 2012, I had a hysterectomy, which catapulted me. And for some reason, 11 years later, I'm still experiencing menopause. Like, what the heck is wrong, right? I don't get hardly no sleep. I have night sweats. You know, like, I have hot flashes. These things are very uncomfortable. It makes for a very irritable me, right? Well, thank God for his favor, right, and his grace. None of you all have had to experience her pray a lot. Man, I was up all night, not because I was preparing. I was like, Lord, please help me sleep. It's hot. I turned the air on. I have like 5 fans going at one time. And still, my body is combusting from the inside out. It is miserable. But I trust God. I've been praying for 11 years. Lord, please take this thing away from me. Grateful not to have that monthly situation. But I don't know. I don't know. Our lions could be our financial difficulties, so, you know, some money struggles that we can encounter. A lot of times, well, every year, during the summer months, and I'm solo bolo. I'm a single mom. I live by myself. Don't take that as an invitation. I got stalkers. Don't come over uninvited. If you know, you know. But in the summer months, like, my bills, they triple, right? The electricity bill gets high for some stupid reason. That's the, in August is when my tags are due on my car. There's just like bills on top of bills on top of it. And they collide in June, July, and August. And it sucks. And it sucks. But I trust and believe God always, always. This is the first semester that I actually taught summer school at the college, because normally I take the summer off. But I felt like, you know, I only took one class for teaching summer school, which is going to be my regular gig now, because summer school offers bonuses. I was like, what is this? What is this? This is overflow. Thank you, Lord, for meeting the needs. He came through when it is almost seemingly impossible. I don't have a backup plan when my bills are high. I don't have a go-to person except for God himself. Lord, I expect you to meet all of my needs. I want to eat still in the summer. I want to stay cool. I don't need an additional heat component because my body is already doing its thing. Like, Lord, help me. These are my lions. These are my lions. Broken relationships, right? I'm still experiencing family trauma. Still single. I don't know if that's a broken relationship. That just is what it is. I think I like me too much. I don't know what not being single would be like for me at this point. I don't have no space for nobody to do nothing in my space. I have a 4-bedroom house. It's just me. I turned one room into a walk-in closet. I turned one room into a gym. I did leave my baby a space for when he come back. You can come. But I got ideas. I got ideas. And then there's the queen's room herself. That's that real. For those who know. Okay. That's that keep going. Okay. Anyway, so these are our lions that we are experiencing right now. And like Daniel, we have to find ourselves in the midst of daunting circumstances. And Jesus tells us in the book of John that in this world we will have trouble. We are not exempt from it. We are not too holier that we cannot experience what's happening in real time, in real lives. Our bodies mess up, our money mess up, our kids mess up, things mess up. In this world, the world in and of itself, we're still getting ready to take a second wave of COVID. We're still getting some things going on with that. We're having all kinds of battles with the letters, the LGBTs and the Qs and the pluses. There's a lot of stuff going on. In this world, we will have trouble, he tells us. But he also said in that same verse that take heart because he has overcome this world. When facing life's lions, we must remember that God is with us, just as he was with Daniel. And we are not alone in our battles. Second thing I want to talk about, the third thing, is divine deliverance. We have God's faithful protection. In the lion's den, God's intervention was nothing short of miraculous, right? How many of us can testify to miraculous moments where we were in situations that seem inescapable? Like, we can't get out of this. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know where this is coming from, the money. I don't know how my child is going to get out of this situation. I don't know what to do about this. But then God sent his Holy Spirit, and he gave us an answer. We were talking last month with the ladies about sometimes, you know, God always have a provision. He always has a provision. When we were talking about how he fed the multitude with five loaves and two fish, and he told them to sit down, sit down. He gave thanks and he broke the bread and he told the disciples to pass it out. Not once did he say, all of a sudden, there was 25,000 loaves of bread, and all of a sudden, the fish just multiplied before our very eyes. What he said was, take what you have and give it. Just what a pastor was talking about right now. Take what you have and give it. And watch God do the miraculous. The miraculous is not for us. If we could do miracles, then we would still be doing miracles, right? We do miracles through the grace of God. And we do miracles by our obedience. Sit down. Sit down was because a lot of times we need to take the time to listen. There is guidance in what he's talking about. There is direction in what he's saying. We're trying to spin our wheels, trying to figure things out. And I'm a figalizer, okay? My little nephew made that word up. He said, you got to figalize. That means you got to figure it out and realize at the same time. Listen, you got to figalize. And I'm a figalizer. I be trying to figure stuff out and realize if it's going to happen or not. But sometimes I need to sit down. Sit down, pray to my Lord, tell him my needs, and listen. Listen, the instructions are definitely on the other side of that. He said, take it. He gave thanks, meaning give thanks for what you have. Right now, he will do this to multiplying. He will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. It's already done, but it is something that we do have to participate in. We have to be quiet sometimes and listen to what he is saying to us. We have to trust that he will divinely deliver us from the things, our situations that we have no answers for. That's why he's God and we're not, right? That's why he's God. We have to trust that he will send his Holy Spirit. He will send his angels even still, as he did with Daniel. He will shut the mouths of your lions, whatever they are, whatever your lions are. He promises that he will be with us through them and provide us with strength, and he will give us peace, and he will give us comfort. It's interesting that his promises are always good, that in the midst of our crazy times, our trials and tribulations, that we actually have strength. The Bible tells us that when we are weak, then he is made strong. And that translates to the people around us. That translates. Like, how is it that she's getting through that? How is it that she's managing that? How is it that she's still smiling in the midst? He gives us strength. He gives us peace. And peace is a hot commodity, people. Peace is something that if you get a hold of it, don't ever let it go. Don't ever let nobody take that from you. Not one thing, not one situation, not one circumstance. Do not ever relinquish your peace to the trials of this world, to people. because God supplies peace that surpasses all understanding, meaning there's no reason for you to be peaceful right now. There's no reason for you to be calm, cool, and collected right now. The whole world is surrounding you, is messing up, right? But still, in that situation, he gives you peace, he gives you strength, and he gives you comfort. Sometimes we experience things that grief and loss, and there's nothing we can do about that either, right? It hurts. Our heart hurts for losing loved ones. Our heart hurts for whatever type of loss we can take, but God also sends us comfort in those moments, and he loves on us so unconditionally. Psalms 46 and 1 says, God is our refuge and strength, and ever-present help in trouble. Isaiah 41 and 10 says, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand. Romans 8 and 31 says, what then shall we say in response to these things? And these things could be all of your lions. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, then who, and I added the what, can be against us? Amen. We can take a pause with that. Yes. Ooh. That is powerful to know. That is powerful that if God be for us, then who or what can stand against us? And then everybody's favorite, Psalms 23, says, the Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. That's that sit down. And he leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right path for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valleys, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, hence the Daniel haters. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word. And this is what we have access to. This is our fuel for when we're suffering. This is our fuel for when we're going through hard times. All of these scriptures should be the ones that make us shout. These are the things that give us that peace. These are the word we go and we have our quiet time with God, however you do it, and you get full off of the word so much that your cup flows over. I told you guys before that your cup flows over. See, the overflow of your cup is for everybody else. What's in the cup is for you. Your cup can't overflow if it's not full. So fill yourself up with the word. That's for you. That is for you. Fill yourself up with the word so that when you have so much of it and you can share that with your, it overflows. It runs over. The run over is so that somebody else can feast off of how good God is. They can look at your life and understand or know why God is what he's doing in your life. It's an amazing thing. My next and last point is, it's a testimony of God's power. Daniel's stand served as a witness to the king, right? The king already knew how Daniel felt about the God that he served. He already knew about his heart, but he was able to see it in action. He was able to see that Daniel had unwavering faith. He was able to see it. He was able to see it because he had to give the decree. He had to carry out the order. And listen, if your God that you continuously pray to, I see you doing that, but How good is your faith? Not once in our text did Daniel's like, please, come on, you know me better than that. Come on now. I'll, you know, put me on the side. Like, he didn't try to hustle his way out of it. He accepted whatever was going to happen, and he allowed God to make the stand. Daniel's stand served as a witness to the king. His experience in the lion's den became a powerful testimony to King Darius, so much so. And this is how we know that the lions was still hungry. He said, the king said, all right, get Daniel out of there. Get him out of there. And all you haters and your wife and kids, I'm going to put y'all in there. And the Bible tells us that before they even landed, that the lions ravished them, crushing every bone. That is huge. This led the king to acknowledge the greatness of Daniel's God. Our unwavering faith and trust in God can also serve as a testimony to the people around us. Where is your stand? Where is your faith? What do you do when it's not popular? When everybody around you is doing things that is not representing what God says, is not giving God favor, is not giving him glory, is not giving him honor. Where is your position? Where is your position when you are in amongst all the lions in your life? What is your position? Do you think about doing things that are not legal just because I got to do this hustle because that's where my money's going to come from? Or are we trusting God? Where are we unwavering? Is our faith unwavering? And if it is, we have room for improvement, right? The good thing about God is he has sent his son to die for us for our sins once and for all. We are a finished work. And therefore, our bad decisions, we're not a whole sum total of our bad decisions, right? We make bad decisions. We do stupid stuff sometimes. However, God is God. His favor, his mercy is everlasting. And we get every opportunity to do it right the next time, to grow and to be better for it, to be testimonies. And this is the stuff from how my walk to God has come to where people that I have led to Christ, this is the stuff that they want to see. They want to see that real stuff, right? They don't want somebody just quoting scriptures to them. They want to see that thing manifested and playing out in your life. They don't want you just like, oh, thyest is the wrongeth of thy Lord. I said verily unto thee, Felicia, sit thee down. Right? You know, whatever. They don't want to hear all these things. They want to see that a real God can service a real situation in real time right now. Right now. We don't want to hear really about Daniel and the lion's den when my bill is due. I don't care about Daniel. Right? I don't want to hear about how he parted the Red Seas when my bills are due. Well, my kids are acting up. I want to know, what does he do now in real time in real situations with real people? Right? That's us. We're the real people. We're the real people. We're the real people that demonstrates our life. We live our lives. We're not being fake and phony. We go through, thank you very much. We go through, yeah, I'm getting all soggy up here. Good Lord. Yeah, I'm glistening. I was glistening up there. I'm soggy right here. The glisten has gone away, but God is good. It reminds me of Sarah Jakes Roberts when her wig came off and she kept going, God is God. He will do what he's going to do. However it looks, it is what it is. Hallelujah. So, again, our testimony, live your lives. But live your lives honoring God, giving God the glory. Live your lives checking in with God, praying, developing a relationship with him so that this is genuine. This is not something that's fake and phony. If you do it in the good times, it's easy in the bad times. So here's my takeaways. Number one, learn to embrace unwavering faith. Okay, let's see how we do that. That sounds good. That sounds kind of like religion-y, right? Learn to embrace unwavering faith. Okay. Practical, right? Soch 101. How do we do that? How do we do that? Well, if you haven't started, start by developing a regular prayer life. Prayer is your direct line of communication with God. And don't just say the regular things. Get intimate with God. Tell him about your desires. Tell him about your fears. Tell him about your doubts. Tell him about your dreams. Get intimate with God. Talk to him. Share your hopes, your fears, and then sit down and allow him to speak to your heart. Allow him to tell you the desires of his heart for you. Develop a regular prayer life. It takes you a long way, right? If you do it in the good times, when times are hard, it's not just a default, something that you go to when times are hard. It's just a regular conversation still. It's still something that, God, you know me. I know. Listen, you see this? What are you going to do? What are you going to do? And we can have those kind of regular conversations or be like that with God if we develop a relationship with him, right? Lord, I don't even have to say to him, look at it, look at this, right? That little kid of mine that's in Oregon, I want to fight him, I do. And it's a good thing that he's in Oregon, right? So I tell the Lord, do what you do in Oregon, Lord. Do what you do in Oregon. Don't let him come back to the Antelope Valley until, hallelujah, you have done what you have done. So I don't have to did what I'm going to do. Okay, I don't know. Listen, finish it. Save him. He belonged to you too. Also, develop trust in God. Now, that also sounds very cliche. How do we do that? Well, trust is at the very core of faith. Trust that God loves you unconditionally. That's where you start. Trust that he loves you unconditionally and that he has a plan for your life, even when your circumstances seem challenging. And a good way to do that is to reflect on your past experiences. What has he gotten you out of? What has he done for you already? I mean, do those in the quiet times. Do those in when things are not so tumultuous. Do it like, God, you know what? Think about it. Reflect on the things. God, he really has gotten me through that. He's really taken my child and done some great things. And what has he done here in DWC? What has he done in the life of your friends? What has he done in the lives of people around you? Use all that. Take it all in to develop a trust for God where he's been faithful and trust that he will continue to be. Trust in God's protection and his guidance, even in the faces of life's giants. How do you do that? We stay persistent. Faith is not a one-time decision. It is a lifelong journey. There will be moments of hardship when times are hard and difficult and challenging, but continually be that Daniel and continually seek after God, continually talk to God, continually believe and trust, and watch him work it out. He will work it out. Be patient with yourself. This is how we can trust in God. Be patient with yourself. Give yourself grace to know and understand that faith is a process, but it's a process that cannot fail. If you give grace and you're, oh, dang, I really messed that up. I wish I would have trusted God a little bit more in that situation. I had went to South Bend, Indiana one time. I had clients out there, and I went to South Bend, and it was super snowing at that time. And I'm a California girl. I don't do snow that much unless it's intentional. But I had to go to South Bend. I got a car. I rented a car, and they don't come with chains. I mean, these people know how to drive like that. I didn't know how to drive in South Bend, so I'm fishtailing. I'm doing all kind of crazy stuff. So I go see my client. It was a turnaround. And so then I'm trying to go back to the airport so I can catch my flight. But I'm looking around like it's really pretty out here. But I got to get back to the airport. And so I'm driving down the street, and I go far, and like, where am I? I don't know. So then I'm fixing the GPS, and it was like, oh, I passed it. So I turn around. I go back the other way. And now I feel like I was where I started, and I'm like, I didn't see the airport. So I passed it. I did it again. Oh, gosh. Like, why do I keep passing? So I was going back and forth down this same street at least a good 5 to 10 times. And I started crying. And I was like, oh, my God, I don't want to be out here. I'm just hollering to myself. Finally, I hunked this lady down. The lady was like, I was like, where's the airport? She's like, right there. I was like, no, it's not. It's not right there. She's like, follow me. Follow me. I said, okay. She took me to the airport, which looked like a post office. That's right. It don't look like no airport. It looked like a post office. That's why I kept passing it up. I saw the flag, but I was like, no, that's the post office. She's like, no, that's it. That's it, honey. You're okay. And in that moment, like, when I finally got on the plane, and I was on the plane like, thank you, Lord, for not letting me miss my flight. Thank you, Lord. He's like, but what you did miss was my beauty. It was gorgeous. What I did miss was the whole environment, the atmosphere. I missed it because I panicked. I did not take the opportunity to observe an environment that I've never been in and enjoy it for God's pleasure. I mean, this was his good work, right? That I hardly ever get to see here in California, right? I could have enjoyed it, but I didn't. I panicked, and I thank God for getting me out the panic. But then I was like, dang, you really messed up. You really messed up. You could have. Now, I'm not going to go back to South Bend to enjoy it. I'll enjoy it someplace else. But what I did do was I gave myself grace. Like, okay, be more alert next time. Don't jump, rush into panic mode. But take a moment to pause and like, Lord, because I'm pretty sure if I would have stopped and paused, Lord, I think, where is the airport? He would have, like, you are passing it up. It is right there. Okay. I would have gotten to the airport one way or the other, right? But I could have experienced God in a greater way if I allowed myself to do so. But am I going to beat myself up about it? No, it's a good story to tell to y'all, right? It's a good learning opportunity that God is always in the mix. He's always there. He is an ever-present help in time of trouble. He is, and he does more, actually, in foresight than he does in hindsight. We typically catch it in hindsight, though. He does a lot in foresight, Araceli, right? He does a lot in the unseen, right? And if we just take our moments to rest, keep our eyes on him, if we had that continual, perpetual relationship, Lord, then we will be able to catch the moments, be guided, instead of looping around, right? It happened to them in Israel. They was looping around. I mean, that ain't new. We loop around. We do all kinds of stuff that we don't have to because we don't take the moments to stop and pause and listen to what God is saying. But give yourself grace. You got now to do it, right? You got tomorrow to do it. We have the time to do it because his grace is sufficient in all things. Amen. Let me make sure. And then, lastly, be willing to be a testimony. Don't be shy about sharing your experiences with others about how good God has been in your life. Don't be shy about that. That is, like I told you guys before, the very way that I came to know Christ as I do is because I seen him working in somebody else's life. And that person never was shy about talking about it. She didn't care how I felt about God or she didn't care where I was in my relationship with God. She didn't care. All she knew was that God was good to her. God is so good. Let me tell you what he did. God is so good. Let me tell you what he did. God is so good. Let me tell you, girl, let me tell you what God did. Like, God, you love me too, right? I mean, let me see what he. So don't be shy about sharing your experience about how good God is, because that could be the very thing that draws somebody to God. Share the ugly stuff as well as the good. People need to know a real God in a real situation and a real season. Amen. And then lastly, I just want to say that God will never leave us nor forsake us. He will work it out. Amen.
He will. Work it, work it. Work it, work it, work it. Woo. Work it, work it. Work it, work it, work it. Woo. Work it, work it. Work it, work it, work it. Woo. Work it, work it.
He will work it out. Ty Tribbett hooked us up with that. He will work it out. I just want to be excited about this weekend coming up with the ladies. Our retreat is on Friday. Oh, my gosh. And for those of you ladies who are not going, put it in your mind to go next year. Next year, we're going to actually do Wednesday through Friday instead of, so that we don't have to miss the church on Sunday, which we will be missing on this Sunday. It's okay. But, yeah, so we'll give you dates, and we'll hook you guys up with that. Are you guys blessed today from beginning to end? PT, you closing us out?
Thank you, Monica. Father, right now, just come in agreement for every single person. And even according to the word that you begin to speak, that you're going to move in the unseen. Places that we may not have seen, we will see you move. Places that no one else sees, you're working there for each one of us. And God, we thank you by your Spirit that you are working things out even now. We embrace that. We receive the word and accept it. Accept it for you right now. Accept that for you right now where you are. Father, we accept that. Say this today. Say, Father God, I hear your word and I accept it for me. I believe that you are working on my behalf, on my family's behalf. You are and you will work it out. Say, I believe it, I receive it. And give him a shout of thank you in Jesus' name. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you for it. Thank you for it all, Lord. Amen. We'll have our prayer warriors up here to pray with you if you need prayer for anything. And tonight we have at 6:30 to 9:30, Corso Park. Is that what it is? Corson Park. And it's, I think, what, 5th Street East on Palmdale, 9th Street East, Palmdale Boulevard. We're going to be there 6:30 to 8:30. It's a suicide awareness event. So if you want to come out and let's support our community and be there, PT will be singing. I know Janet's going to be ministering. You know, we're all going to be there. And so let's agree with that. So let's say our motto of faith today, like we mean it. Grace happens here. Grace happens in me and through us. Amen. God bless you all. We love you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for coming here. We love you, all those online. Bless you. We'll see you tonight or Wednesday night on Bible study.